Good morning. I want you to grab your Bible and I want you to turn to Genesis chapter 1. And we are going to begin in verse 1. Our plan today is to cover Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 through chapter 2, verse 3. While you're finding your place, I do want to just welcome any of our guests that are here with us. We are so thankful that you've joined us in worship. We'd love to get to know you. I hope that you received a worship folder on your way in, and inside this worship folder, you'll see a card that looks like this. So if you're new this morning with us, go ahead and consider filling out your information. We just want to get acquainted, find out how we might be able to get to know you and maybe minister to you as a church family. On the other side of this card, we ask for everybody in here, consider setting a prayer request. Just write that down. And you leave those cards in your seat on your way out. We have folks that will come through and pick those up. During the week, if you come up with a prayer request, email us those, acts6@chapinbaptist.com. If you think of questions that you might want to ask of our church, you can certainly email those to info@chapinbaptist.com as well. And I encourage you to look through the rest of your worship folder, see what information that you may be interested in. Lots of things going on. We are so thankful that we have a lot to be able to celebrate that God is doing among us. One of those is to be able to have today our first day sort of back in our normal format. And so I'm very thankful for that. We had an 8:30 service and an 11 o'clock service and had time to take a deep breath in between, which was fantastic. I do want to just say a couple things. I want to encourage everybody just to continue being as respectful as you have been. We know that folks have different opinions and different needs. And different levels of caution that they have to walk in. So I would encourage everybody, just continue to stay cautious, whether it comes to people's choices to wear masks or get a vaccine or not. That's up to everybody to make their own decisions, and everybody seems to have been respectful all along anyway. I just plead with you to continue to do so. Show the world that Chapin Baptist kind of knows how to be respectful and loving and gracious and all that. We are not going to just immediately bring everything back in place. So, for example, we're not passing around offering plates and inviting everybody to touch those on their way through all the pews or anything like that. If you want to continue giving, just as you have been through e-giving or coming to the office, leaving it here on Sunday, you can do that. We're just going to give a little more time before we do some of those things, just to try to continue to have a little caution among us. But praise the Lord, this is 1 year, as I've been told, 1 year to the week that we started meeting back in person with our previous arrangement with a three-service format. So we did that for a year. You guys were awesome. And so we look forward to continuing to move forward as a church. Now, let's start racing through the book of Genesis. I want you to look at the first verse of the Bible. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Let's bow. God, you are worthy of more praise than we could give you. 100 billion worship services wouldn't cut it. We praise you. We give you the glory as our creator. And we thank you for your grace. Grace that we never fully appreciate, ever. We thank you for all of it. Almighty God, I pray that with the same power of your word that you use to create everything, that you would use the same power of your word among us right now. Because God, we need that kind of power. We're desperate for it. And we know we can only find it in you. So we beg you for it. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. We are indeed going to race through Genesis. I know it's going to be a year. That seems like a long time. Well, you try preaching through Genesis in a year, you realize, whoa, we are cruising, as we will see today. First things first, you will walk away somewhat disappointed this morning. And don't say, well, we're used to that. Please don't say it loud anyway. You will walk away somewhat disappointed This text is slammed full of major topics like God, with all the implications of monotheism that the book of Genesis is pummeling into the culture that the Israelites were walking into, with all the implications of the Trinity that we'll see hints of. That's just one of the topics in this text. Consider creation. Everybody walks in with all these questions about creation. How did God create the heavens and the earth? How long ago? How long did it take him? Or the topic of humanity. What is the origin of mankind? Like, that's what we're trying to tackle today in this text as one of the many topics. The dominion that we are given over creation. The subject of gender, God creating in male and female. Even think about a topic like the environment. We're introduced to the animal kingdom. We're introduced to plant life. The text finishes with a topic such as Sabbath. You're going to walk away somewhat disappointed because you all have questions about all those things, and I've actually got very few answers. You will be somewhat disappointed, but you will not be debated. I want you to know this. I am not up here to debate you. I'm not called to apologetically defend the word. I'm called to preach it. That's what I intend to do as faithfully as we can. It may help if I could just at least lay one statement out there just so folks can have some answers of what he think. I believe that we can trust in God's word, that he created it the way we see it written. I do believe that God created it in the days described in Genesis 1. I want to say something very intentionally. So I assume that means they were 24-hour days. If you want to ask me why I said it that way, I want you to reach out to me. I would love to discuss these things with you. I have no desire to debate them with you. I want to preach, and I want to discuss the Word of God. Look at verse 1 again, and I want you to listen to a pronouncement. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. So, if a millennial was going to tweet a response, an emotional response to Genesis 1 verse 1, they would tweet, biggest period, pronouncement period, ever period. And it's the first verse of the Bible. This is the biggest pronouncement ever. God created the heavens and the earth. Everything hinges on that statement. And it's the first statement in Scripture. This is a massive book. I hope you hear that pronouncement. But we have to detect a problem. Already in verse 2, there's a problem. Now, on my notes, I've got the word problem surrounded with quotation marks. So we listen to this pronouncement, and then very soon after it, we detect a problem here. Let me point it out. The first part of verse 2. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. All right, the idea of the deep waters. You say, well, explain that. Well, we'll sit down for coffee. We'll discuss it. This problem of nothingness. The earth was without form. It's formless. Just try to imagine it. The problem of emptiness. The earth was without form and void. The problem of darkness. And I wonder if it surprises you like it surprises me. Does it surprise you that in verse 2 of the Bible, there's already a problem? detected. Now, most of you know problems are coming real quickly in Scripture, like real quickly, real big problems. But does it surprise you that already in verse 2, I'm saying, look, we can detect a problem, so to speak? Well, I hope that even if it surprises you, I hope that you will be very encouraged knowing that God is already in the business of addressing problems. Anybody walk in here with problems today? God is in the business of addressing problems. Let Genesis 1 encourage you the way that it would have encouraged Joshua. Think about it. Joshua succeeded Moses, charged to take the people of God into the promised land where they knew that armies waited them. And God tells Joshua in Joshua chapter 1, be strong and courageous. Meditate on the book. This part, the part that Moses produced. Don't turn from it left or right. Can you imagine Joshua being thankful that he could go all the way to the second verse of the Bible and realize that God was already, from the very beginning, in the business of resolving problems? And we see a kiss of hope. Look back in verse 2, the second part of verse 2. I want you to see this kiss of hope that we have. And the Spirit of God. The word for spirit is the same word used for breath. The Spirit of God, or the breath of God, was hovering over the face of the waters. Do you see this kiss of hope? Right where the darkness was over the face of the deep, the Spirit of God, the breath of God, is hovering over the face of the waters. And what we're about to see is that God... And I want you to hear this. You need to hear this for all the details in your life. God speaks light and form and fullness into a world that is dark and formless and void. Anybody feel that way from time to time? Life ever seem empty? Future ever seem dark? You ever unsure of what shape things are going to take? God speaks light and form and fullness into a world that is dark and formless and void. I want you to see, as we really cruise through this text, the plan that God does carry out to address the problem. Look at verse 3. Let's watch as God forms what was a formless world. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. I realize you're like, whoa, at this pace, bro, we're going to be here through dinner. Just trust me, we'll speed up. God said, let there be light. And there was light. That's power, y'all. How many of you lost your power a couple weeks ago? Yeah, we didn't. I'm not kidding. It flickered like once, and I just kept reading under my lamplight. Look, oh, man, the rest of Chapin. I don't know. We're living right over here. I don't know. You lost your power, right? No, what that means is your lights wouldn't come on. When did you find out you got your power back? When the lights woke you up at 4 a.m. This is power. If I stood up here and had the lights turned off and said light and the lights came back on, you would assume rightly that I planted someone out there to push the button. But if I said, turning the lights off, and I said light and it got bright in here, and then you realize the light bulbs aren't even on, but it's still bright, that's power. We worship a God who has light without the bulb. I wonder if you realize how paradigm shifting that is for everything. Even how we think about the word day. All right, let's keep going. Verse 4. God saw that the light was good. Now just pay attention as we continue to go quicker, all the repetition that God put into his word. And God separated the light from the darkness. Creation is a repeated work of separation that you'll see. God called the light day. It was day before the bulb. The darkness he called night. And there was evening and there was morning, the first day. And God said, let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters. And God made the expanse, and he separated the waters that were under the expanse from the waters that were above the expanse. And it was so. You're going to see that phrase over and over and over again. It was so. God called the expanse heaven. It's the same word for sky. And there was evening and there was morning the second day. And God said, let the waters under the heavens be gathered together in one place, and let the dry land appear. And it was so. God called the dry land earth. And the waters that were gathered together, he called seas. Does it encourage you that we're here worshiping the God who named the earth? That's how powerful he is. Earth. Seas. God saw that it was good. Verse 11. And God said, let the earth sprout vegetation. Now, I want you to notice more separation, more distinguishing plants yielding seed and fruit trees bearing fruit in which is their seed, each according to its kind on the earth. And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed according to their own kinds, and trees bearing fruit in which is their seed, each according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning, the third day. And God said, now it gets really intriguing, let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens. The God who on day one said, let there be light, on day four, let there be lights to separate the day from the night. I just can't help but think that, like, it's like he's creating something and delegating. Like, he separated the day from the night day one. He's so creative now. He's like, I'll create some universal light bulbs. Let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years. Let them be lights in the expanse of the heavens to give light upon the earth. And it was so. And God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, and the lesser light to rule the night and the stars. You ever wondered why it didn't just say God made the sun and the moon? Scholars point out, Joshua's leading the people into a world where the cultures worshiped the sun. They worshiped the moon. The book of Genesis is arming the people of God to go into the dark world and say, there is one God. We don't worship the sun or the moon. We worship the God who created them. One of them is bigger than the other, the greater light and the lesser light. And God set them in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good, and there was evening and there was morning, the fourth day. And here we see that one of the major problems we encounter in verse 2 is resolved. The earth that was without form is now formed. And now we see it filled. God said, let the waters swarm with the swarms of living creatures. Let birds fly across the earth, above the earth, across the expanse of the heavens. So now, just back going into the same order, now he's dealing with the seas and the sky and separating the earth, filling them. God created the great sea creatures and every living creature that moves, with which the waters swarm according to their kinds, every winged bird according to its kind, and God saw that it was good. And then something different happens. God blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply and fill the waters and the seas. and let birds multiply on the earth. And there was evening and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures according to their kinds, livestock and creeping things, unfortunately. Any encounters with creeping things lately? We've had a few in our office. Those are interesting moments. Where am I? The beast of the earth, according to their kinds, and it was so. And God made the beast of the earth according to their kinds, and the livestock according to their kinds, and everything that creeps on the ground according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, and don't let your familiarity with the story keep you from scratching your head a little bit. God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. I've been standing up here repeatedly letting you know that this Bible is teaching us about one God. What's this us business? Some say, well, maybe it's the royal we. Could be. I don't think so. I'm not convinced. Others say, well, maybe it's sort of the heavenly council, the angelic host, and that makes good sense. Perhaps there is some truth to that. I would even say that Moses and those in his day and age may have very naturally thought that. And yet, we have a completed Bible. And as you'll see towards the end, there's a little more to it, I think. God says, let us make man, make mankind, humankind, in our image. Let's make icons of us. After our likeness, let's make something that's very similar to us. What in the world does it mean? You know, it could take a series of sermons just to explain, try to explain, begin to explain what it means to be made in the image of God. But we do have a few hints. It says, and let them have dominion. There's our first clue. So whatever dominion means, this is our first clue of what it means to be made in the image of God. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the heavens, over the livestock, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. When you squash it, dominion right there. That's one clue. Being made in the image of God is being given this stewardship, this responsibility of dominion. Another clue in verse 27, and while I read it, count the number of times you encounter the word created. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, him, male and female, he created them. Three times the word created is used. You may know when we see something repeated three times in Hebrew, like the phrase, holy, holy, holy. It's emphasizing, it's superlative. This verse three times mentions that humans are created. Twice it reminds us we're created in the image of God. And then it finishes, it culminates by saying male and female. There's another clue. What does it mean to be made in the image of God? Well, we may not be able to wrap our minds around all of it, but there's something about this complementary relationship that they're created in. Kind of echoes the idea of letting us make man in our image, and now male and female, he created them. Look what it says in verse 28, just like we encountered previously once. And God blessed them. And God said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it. And have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over every living thing that moves on the earth. And God said, behold, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is on the face of all the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food, and to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the heavens, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food, and it was so. In other words, the world is formed, the world is filled. He has prepared a world for those he made in his image. Verse 31. And God saw that everything that he had made, he saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Now I want us to consider briefly what was very good. Look down at the text. Everything that he had made, everything. The light, the expanse, the seas and the earth and the vegetation, and the stars, and the moon, and animals, and then the crowning jewel of creation, humans. It was very good. The only thing I would quibble with is the vegetarian diet. By God's grace, it gets resolved pretty soon in the story. God formed the world. God filled the world. And let's see God finish his work. Chapter 2, verse 1. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day, God finished his work that he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and made it holy. In other words, he set it apart, special, because on it God rested from all his work that he had done in creation. He finished his work. And we have a promise in Scripture. We have a promise that echoes this finished work that God enjoys. It's the promise of rest. A rest that we can only find in relationship with him. Listen to Hebrews 4, 9 and 10. So then, there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For whoever has entered God's rest has also rested from his works as God did from his. We are invited into a relationship where God promises us that there is a rest to enjoy when everything is finished. Because that's what he did when he was finished. So here's what I want you to do. You're going to really like me for this. Hopefully you really liked me last week when I said, look, you need to live according to God's word, respect your preacher, and like go eat a massive meal. Okay? For those of you who weren't here last week, hey, that's your problem. But those who came to worship got to go eat and not feel too guilty about it. And I did. I mean, Tuesday. Oh, the staff can attest to it. Today, here's what I'm telling you to do. Sometime soon, and I realize it could be real soon for some of you, go take a nap. I mean a good, long nap. Tell your spouse, tell your kids, tell whoever you need to tell. The preacher said, I got to go take a nap. Now do not kick back on the recliner and take a cat nap for 10 minutes. No, don't do that. Get in your pajamas. Go get in your bed. Turn the lights off, make the blinds as dark as possible. I mean, put foil on the windows like college. Whatever you got to do, disappear from the world and take a nap. I want you to rest, to remind yourself you do not carry the weight of the world on your shoulders. Did you know you don't make the world spin around? That's why we get to sleep. God doesn't do that. And I know that there are heavy shoulders walking into this room, and I want you, if serious, go find a time soon and take a nap and say, God, I'm going to take a nap, even though it feels counterintuitive for some of us. Like, I don't feel like I should do this. It's a waste of my time. There's something to take care of. Yes, make a wise decision when you do it, but when you do it and say, God, I want to rest. And know that that nap somehow is a hint of eternity for you if you have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ. That's our promise, rest. But we have a big problem. And when I wrote this word problem, I didn't put quotation marks in it. We have a problem, and I'll just assign it the label restlessness. Because I realize that when I say you don't carry the weight of the world on your shoulders, you don't make the world spin around, I know you have weight on your shoulders, and I'm telling you to rest. You may say, I got a problem. I have a problem of restlessness. It feels like everything in life is anything but restful right now. And so you may see me read through this account of creation, and I keep saying, God saw it and it was good, and God saw it and it was good, and God saw it and it was good. And then I get to that point where I say, God saw everything he made and it was very good. And you may genuinely be asking, what happened to the very good? Like, if everything was made very good, then why do so many things in life feel really bad? Let's go ahead and just admit that to one another. Do you realize that there's a lot of things that swirl around me that feel really bad? And I think I have it easy compared to a lot of you guys. I know that life can be really bad right now. So let's ask, what happened to the very good? Why does every headline look horrible? Why does every conversation in our family feel strained, if there is a conversation? Why does my future always seem so bleak? Why can't I shake this lust? Why can't I just admit to God and others that I am in desperate need of help? What happened to the very good? Well, here's what's happened. Now, here's what we could do. I could go to chapter 3, but you may not come back in a couple weeks. I want you to come back, so I'm not going to go to chapter 3. Plus, it'd be easy to look at a couple scapegoats in chapter 3. I want us to look at ourselves. Just listen to this. Here's the answer to the question, what happened to the very good? Romans chapter 1, beginning in verse 18. Here's Paul's explanation. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven, the very heaven he created, against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. Oh, I hope this resonates with you. For what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made. And listen to what he says next. So they, and I would include us, we, so they are without excuse. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him. But they became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Right? So they worshiped the sun, or they worship the moon, or the goddess of the sea. I mean, how dumb can you get, right? Yeah, let's keep reading. This is about to climb in our lap. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things. Therefore, God gave them up in the lust of their hearts to impurity, to the dishonoring of their bodies among themselves, because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshiped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Now, you may feel a little distance from this accusation, but we keep reading because Paul kept writing. For this reason, God gave them up to dishonorable passions. For their women exchanged natural relations for those that are contrary to nature. And the men likewise gave up natural relations with women and were consumed with passion for one another, men committing shameless acts with men and receiving in themselves the due penalty for their error. Hang on, Paul keeps reading. Since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to a debased mind to do what ought not to be done. They were filled, you ready? With all manner of unrighteousness, evil, covetous, malice. Even there, we could be like, okay, we're doing okay. Full of envy. You realize our envy oozes all over Facebook. Covetousness, malice, deceit, murder, strife, maliciousness. They are gossips. Got you right there. And me too. Gossips. What happened to the very good? Gossip happened to it. What happened to the very good? Did you hear about so-and-so? That happened. Slanderers, haters of God, insolent, haughty, boastful. What happened to the very good? You bragging about yourself most of the time without being honest. Trying to get people to think life is better than it is. Inventors of evil. Now, I for one would say I don't feel like I immediately fall into the category of being an inventor of evil, but the next one gets all of us from one time to another, disobedient to parents. What happened to the very good? Kids happen. Verse 31, foolish, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Listen to this. Though they know God's righteous decree that those who practice such things deserve to die. Okay, first, before. Listen to this and then throw yourself and the rest of our culture in it. Though they know God's righteous decree that those who practice such things deserve to die. It would be like saying, though we all know deep down that there is such a thing as absolute truth and right and wrong, they not only do them, but give approval to those who practice them. Welcome to America. And I don't say that as an American hater. No. I love this place. I'm part of this place. As chapter 2, verse 1 would tell all of us, therefore you have no excuse. You have no excuse. Oh man, every one of you who judges, for in passing judgment on another, you condemn yourself because you, the judge, practice the very same things. That's Paul's way of answering our question, what happened to the very good? Why do so many things seem really bad? So, is there any hope? When we got started, I said, here's a pronouncement, here's a problem, here's a kiss of hope. Then I said, we got a real big problem. Is there any hope? Yes. There is always hope, biblically. I want to prove it to you. John chapter 1, there's hope from the beginning. Listen to this. This is how the book of John starts. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Let us make man in our image. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him. All things were made through this word. And without him, without this word, was not anything made that was made. In him was life. And the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness. Here's the hope. And the darkness has not overcome it. There's been hope from the beginning. You say, but yeah, we've made a mess of things since the beginning. That's why John 1 is written. Listen to verse 14. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. Let us make man in our image. Then the mankind that was made made a mess of things. So God sent his Son, Jesus, And in a way, you can say Jesus took on our image. Philippians 2. Though he was in the form of God, he took on the form of a servant, being made in the likeness of man. There's hope through Jesus Christ. We're told in verse 16 that from him, from his fullness, we have all received grace upon grace. I want you to know, for those of you who woke up feeling that life is dark and formless and void, it may be because you do not have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ. It may be because you need to be reminded or have that relationship refreshed, but if you feel a darkness and a formlessness and a void, it may be because you do not know Jesus. Jesus came to bring life and light, and the darkness cannot overcome him, and he's flowing with grace upon grace, like the waves of the ocean that he created to flood the grace all over you. And we know that this Jesus came into this world that was an absolute atrocity of a mess. And he went to the cross. And as he hung on that cross, he said, "It is finished." There's always hope. There's been hope from the beginning. There's hope for eternity. As we close, I want you to listen. A passage we read quite frequently here. Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 through 5. "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them. They will be his people. God himself will be with them as their God.'" And yet again, we read this over and over, but again, with every detail of your life that you came in carrying the weight of the world for, "He will wipe away every tear from their eyes." The tears I saw in the lobby right before I came in here. "He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, no more grieving, no crying, nor pain anymore. For the former things have passed away." How can God promise this? Because of what verse 5 says. "He who is seated on the throne said, 'Behold, I am making all things new.'" Will you bow with me? Let me just plead with those of you who do not profess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. The rest that the Bible promises is only available through Jesus. The light that overcomes the darkness, the form of abundant life that eradicates formlessness, the fulfilling presence of God that just floods away emptiness, it's only found in Jesus. Would you consider confessing your sin right now in your spirit and say, "Jesus, thank you for finishing the work of redemption. He died for you on the cross. He rose from the grave. He's making all things new." The Bible tells us if you believe in Jesus, you are a new creation. Now, I want to say something to those of you who have tears. This goes for tears for any reason whatsoever. Shame, despair, compassion, fear, pain. I want to remind you, God is making all things new. He has resolved our biggest problems. And he is in the business of speaking light into formlessness and emptiness. God, I pray in similar fashion that I did before the sermon, that you would speak. Speak by your power. By the same power that you just said light, would you please speak right now? In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you stand as we respond to God's word this morning? Wonder, consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. And sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. God, his son not sparing, sent him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. How great.
You may be seated. I want to say, if you will, just as we leave, kind of moving forward in these days, if you'll just try to give people space and just kind of do the best you can to respect those who may still need to be cautious, we appreciate your help with that. For our benediction, I would like for you in your spirit to just echo this prayer from Psalm 8. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babies and infants, you have established strength because of your foes to still the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You have given him dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the heavens, and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Amen.